around it, we know that the EGM had decided that 50% subsidy should be given on diesel for the relief of the farmers. But as of now, we know that some of the states are facing drought-like situation, and of course, there are states like Rajasthan and Gujarat, some parts of Gujarat, facing a shortfall of about 64% to 78% of average rainfall. But what are the concerns around this? What is going to be the future like? Is India really prepared to face another situation of drought at the present time? We'll discuss all these aspects in this edition of Insight. And joining me in the studio is the Deputy Editor with The Hindu, Ms. Gargi Parsai, and Dr. Rahubendra Das, Senior Fellow with Research and Information System for Developing Countries. What a big program. Gargi, let's start and understand this situation with you. It's not a new thing that the country will be facing drought now, but you know, much has been said about why this announcement came so late. In fact, I remember sharing on this very panel, we had a discussion and where we are asking our panelists as to why is, if there is going to be a situation like drought, then why isn't that the government announces it now? But it's been too late as now experts are looking at it. What is your point of view?
Well, I don't think it is too late really, because the sowing season is still on. The sowing season will continue at the most till August 15th. So there is still time. And moreover, the monsoon progresses. It moves, you know, it moves from Kerala to the western coast and that way. So the progress of the monsoon has been delayed. Of course, the monsoon set on 5 days later in Kerala this year. So, and the IMD had been giving predictions about monsoon being normal maybe after a week or after a week, you know. So the government kept waiting. And now it appears that the situation is not that good. In parts of Karnataka, we've known that for quite some time. I think monsoon has in a way bypassed that part of Karnataka where sowing has been affected. Parts of Madhya and Marathwada region of Maharashtra. It has not really appeared, not reached the western parts of Rajasthan and Saurashtra and Kutch in Gujarat. So that is a major concern. Plus there is deficit in Northwest region affecting Punjab, Maharashtra, some of those. So the steps that have been taken after it became clear that the monsoon is not really going to arrive in a big way in the next 2 weeks, which are crucial for the last part of it. That is how the steps have been announced.
But Dr. Das, what is your point of view? Is it a little too late, or are we still in a better position? We can certainly do this.
I think that, as she said, it's not too late, and it was definitely incumbent upon the projections and the forecast by IMD. And as we had discussed in this program earlier, that these forecasts are, yes, scientific basis for monsoon prediction, but many times, you know, the nature defeats these projections. And therefore, the government waited. In any case, I feel that it is not too late also because we almost have around 80 million tons of buffer of cereals. So I guess the government has that cushion, and against that cushion, it tried to tune it to around the time when it realized that yes, now there is a rainfall shortage, and now some of the figures in some states or some parts of some states are very high, and therefore at least their initiative to cut the irrigation costs by having a policy of reduced the price of diesel availability is a welcome step, and I'm very sure that that would mitigate some of the rainfall deficit as far as irrigation problems.
That's right. For doing this, the Empowered Group of Ministers had offered that 50% subsidy should be given to the farmers on diesel. At the same time, there is another thing which I said, that is interim assistance of about 38 crore for improving supply of drinking water in these areas, the Karnataka, Maharashtra region, in addition to what generally goes to these states in the form of, you know, under this National Rural Drinking Water program. But how do you think is this move really going to benefit the farmers, number one? And number two, 50% subsidy, do you think that is going to be sufficient?
The thing, the projections about making funds available for drinking water is really making funds visible. The funds are already there, the programs are there, but they have just, you know, lifted them out of something and they have just made it clear to the state government that these funds are available. The situation of drinking water is very severe, I'm told, in Maharashtra. So that's why, and also in Karnataka there is a problem. So that's why these funds have been made available to the state governments, they are there. And the other question about diesel, you know, there has been diesel subsidy was given, I think, about 2 years ago to Bihar and some of these states. What happens is that Punjab and Haryana are irrigated states. But because the reservoir position is low in these states, you know, Bhakra and Pong and other dams, so the farmers have been advised to draw from, they do it, you know, they draw from the groundwater. So that requires more energy, more power and more diesel. Punjab and Haryana have already asked for additional power. They have been given 300 megawatts
That's
additional.
Right.
They have asked for more, they want 1000 megawatts more. Because, you know, they want to save the standing paddy crop. So that's why diesel subsidy has been given, which you know, as probably you know, that it is 50%, which will be borne half an hour by the states and the central government.
That's right. But what is going to be the worst affected crops now, Gargi? What is
the worst effect is going to be on coarse cereals and also on pulses. I think there will be some effect on groundnut because Gujarat takes groundnut and so does Karnataka. There is a certain shortfall in paddy also, but that will be made up because paddy now is also sown well in the eastern region of the country. So that will be made up. So these are the crops that will
But what about the buffer stock that...
the buffer stock is in wheat and rice.
That's right.
So that is this is the rice season.
That's
the kharif season is the rice season. So rice, there are not much concerns. I mean, the output would be okay. And as you know, the wheat and the rice stocks are 80 million tons high. Today we are stocked with 80 million tons, which is a lot higher than the buffer norms. In fact, we are having a problem of storage, how to store that wheat stock. So we are okay with wheat and rice. And I heard the other day the Minister for Food, Mr. Thomas, saying that he has rice stocks of 1 year with him and wheat of 2 years, maybe 3 years. So the country is sufficient in rice and wheat stocks. But there is going to be a problem in coarse cereals and the pulses.
That's right. But with this are attached the sentiments of the farmers, their crops, and of course the relief that the government can provide. How do you look at that aspect, sir? Do you think that as of now, whatever has come up in the limelight, that is these 2-3 measures that the government has announced, that the EGM has decided on, are they sufficient?
I think just to add, one of the other problem areas is oil seeds. And in that, I guess, soya bean and other edible oil, that would be a problem area as well, apart from pulses and things. So I feel the announcement by the government, which is very timely, yes, which is in tune with the monsoon deficit realization. But at the same time, I feel that also in terms of drinking water availability, I think 32 crores is too small at this stage. The subsidy, which is a welcome step in terms of diesel to improve the irrigation costs or to mitigate the irrigation costs, is again welcome step. But as you know, there are criteria. Wherever there will be 50% rainfall deficit, this diesel subsidy would be available there. And I think it will be shared between the states and center. Only time will tell whether this is sufficient or not. But the major area of no announcement, I feel, is in terms of oil seeds, where in any case we are very large importer and consumer of oil seeds, and this is the season when the production of oil seeds are going to
be. Would you agree with that?
There may be a shortfall in ground.
But then,
you know, they are saying that it will be made up by soya.
Okay.
So in that sense,
they would balance it out or something.
And also, since the sowing season is still on, the government is also looking at the area covered.
Hmm.
If you look at the area covered, there are major shortages in coarse cereals and of course pulses, some in oilseeds no doubt, and a little bit in paddy.
Okay.
So that's what the government is basing its estimates on. And if it rains in Gujarat, then who knows that they may be able to sow ground.
But what is the situation like? I mean, the IMD said, of course, there's going to be a delay, but it has not been ruled out completely. As you said, that some parts have been bypassed. Let's say, you're talking about the regions like Karnataka and those parts of Maharashtra.
Yeah.
That's right.
Not the coastal region, the inner regions.
Mm-hmm. But what is it going
to
be like?
The monsoon deficiency is 20% as of now. I don't know if it has come out with the latest figures. Yeah, IMD looked in some 2-3
days ago. About 20-21%
deficiency. Overall, we are hearing that it will be still 94% of the long range, you know, plus minus. But in certain parts, as it's a progress of the monsoon. You know, the way it is progressing, it should have reached western Rajasthan and parts of Gujarat by now, which it has been delayed. So, and there is not very favorable forecast about the monsoon coming in a big proper way in these areas. So there are concerns about Rajasthan and Gujarat.
But what is the, because you know, there is always a comparison between what it was last year, what it is now, how many villages were affected last time, how many are affected now, is there an increase or less? And of course, much has been said about the forecast that is done in India, much has been said about the IMD predictions, how it went wrong in the past, and you know, how exactly is it, how accurate these predictions are. But what is your assessment
as far as the districts are concerned? See, last year it was a very good year. Last year was also a good year. We had good monsoon because of which we had very good food. In fact, we had record food grains production last year. If you compare, you can compare with 2009, when there was a delay in monsoon. Like in June, it didn't rain at all in 2009. And I remember that about 222 districts were affected which had deficient rainfall. This season, the calculation about districts has not really come out as yet. It is being done. But the government has announced that it is ready with contingency plans for about 320 districts.
Yes.
Now the contingency plans, making contingency plans ready doesn't mean that there is a problem in those districts. It is that the
in case there's a problem.
It means to say, yeah, if it doesn't rain till, for instance, 31st July, so has gone now, but it doesn't rain in the first week of August, then this is the plan, this is what you should sow. If it doesn't rain till 15th of August, then you should go for these varieties of seeds. So those are the contingency plans that are ready. But having said that, Karnataka has declared some talukas and all as drought hit. Maharashtra, I believe, has also raised some.
That's
and today,
right.
Haryana has also declared some areas as drought.
Hmm.
So the areas that are drought struck or affected has to come from the states.
Hmm.
The center doesn't announce about areas being droughted because there is a criteria. If 50% of the crop fails or the 50% of the crop doesn't grow or it dries up, then you have to declare those areas. Now the way it is raining these days, you know, in some pockets there is a good rainfall, in some there is no rainfall. So you have to, states have to assess, you know, that which are the areas which fall in that criteria of drought. And three states till now, Karnataka, Maharashtra and now Haryana, have declared parts of the areas.
Fine. So the government has prepared a contingency plan for about 320 districts. And in case there's any problem, then of course there's a plan that is ready on paper. But the problem doesn't really end here. There is always a recurring debate on why we are so dependent on monsoons. Why can't we have a proper irrigation system in our place? Why is it that the farmers will have to always wait for the monsoons in the country? We'll talk about these aspects also. Time for a break.
जननी सुरक्षा योजना में पंजीकृत। करण कराएं, सुरक्षित प्रसव और आर्थिक सहायता दोनों हो पाए।
And now the time comes when we pray to the of sovereign body representing the sovereign people. In
do you take pride in being an Indian? Do you know what role you play in the making of India's democracy? Do you know who takes your voice to parliament? Do you know it all starts with an MP elected by you? Know your MP and be a better informed Indian. Watch Know Your MP every Friday, 8:30 p.m.
हमारे जीवन में बदलाव लाने वाले विज्ञान के ऐतिहासिक प्रयोग जिन्होंने एक्सरे पेनिसिलिन हरित क्रांति ग्रीन हाउस प्रभाव अर्धचालकों एवं रक्त समूहों की खोजों में योगदान दिया आप जानेंगे पाचन की प्रक्रिया और मॉर्गन एवं ग्रिफिथ और सर सीवी रमन के प्रयोगों को धारावाहिक कुछ तुक्के कुछ तीर के माध्यम से देखिए हर शनिवार सुबह 10:30 बजे सिर्फ लोकसभा चैनल पर
Welcome back to Inside and Inside today. We're talking about the concerns around the deficit. Alright, so before going into the break, we were talking about the Egypt's decision of giving about 50% subsidy on diesel to the farmers, maybe some sort of a relief measure that now the government is taking, considering a drought-like situation in some parts of the country. But Dr. Das, as now there is this growing understanding, there are two different aspects here attached to this particular decision. One being, of course, the impact on food inflation, which is generally believed to be a very important factor, because anything wrong happening with the agriculture will immediately translate into your market prices of the commodities that you'll be buying. So that's number one. Number two is, of course, the fuel reforms that the government is planning to do. Let's take the fuel reforms a little later. Start with the food inflation side. What exactly is your understanding in the present circumstances? How are things going to turn out?
One more measure that the government has announced, which we have not touched upon, is their suggestion of waiving of imports of oil cakes to provide relief to livestock. And livestock is also a very important component of the overall agricultural environment. And in that, if you see the chain in terms of the forward linkage of livestock, in terms of the consumption basket, both I mean in the farm sector and in the urban sector, I think this measure will also do a world of good in terms of providing fodder for the livestock at a much affordable prices, which actually cuts down the livestock production, so to say, or the output generated from the livestock, which will have a comforting impact on inflation in general in terms of edible items. Coming specifically to food items, if you define food as cereals plus other things, then as we had discussed that we already have buffer stock for wheat and rice. So I don't see that is going to be a problem in terms of food inflation, if it is channelized properly and it reaches people in an effective way. Food inflation, which includes some of the value-added items, like dairy and sugar-related processed food, I think that might be an area where the linkage between raw materials in food and that going to processed food, which is again adds to the food basket. That is an area where I feel that there might be some problem, because the agriculture industry linkages, where agriculture is actually doing much better. If you see latest NSSO results which have come out today itself, that would be pulled down possibly by the lackluster performance in industry. So I guess food inflation will have to be viewed not only in the context of availability of food, but also in terms of the linkage that it has with industry, where processed food also gets added to the overall food basket and then the implication for the inflation.
Okay. You know, there was this, in fact, I was reading one of the analysis which says that the EGOM perhaps did not try or did not decide anything about imposing curbs on the agriculture, the commodity exports or ban in the futures trade, because it looks at, you know, the stock that we have looks a little, puts us in a very comfortable zone, which is why no decision on the export banning or these kind of a thing. Is that the real picture, or what is it?
After Vigan did not, the empowered group of ministers and Rao, they did not look at prices or import and export. The only decision they took was waiving a duty on oil meal cakes, on import of oil meal cakes. But actually, if they really wanted to help the country, I feel personally that they should have stopped the export of oil meal cakes. Because oil meal, we are exporting a lot of oil meal cakes from India. They go from here, and then, you know, we've taken a decision that the ones we are again bringing back, we are waiving our duty on that, so that fodder and feed is available for livestock. Other than that, pulses are not in, there was a question about commodities market, and pulses are not in the commodities market. So decision on import and export, I think, has been put on hold, and I don't think they are going to tinker with it much. Put on hold till they get some kind of a surety on what will be the production.
Yeah.
As of now, since they are waiting till 15th of August, there is no surety about what will the production be like. Will it be hit because of lower sowing of certain things, certain cereals and pulses or whatever happens, rice. So that is an issue that they did not touch.
But why did they really don't want to tinker it? I mean, as of now, yeah.
Till you have the figures in hand, till you know what your output is going to be like, then wait, you can't take the knee-jerk decisions.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They're just trying to avoid that knee-jerk reaction. Yes, I mean, they just like to wait and see and take a very calm decision.
Yeah, you know, it also has to be understood in this way that trade is a mitigating factor. It bridges the demand-supply gap.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I keep saying this, we cannot be unilateral always in terms of our trade relations. So, if we want to import, we want to import. We don't want to export, we don't want to export. But because trade inherently, by definition, is a bilateral activity between one country and another, possibly it is not good for a country to say, okay, oil cakes, you know, we will import, but we will have a ban on export of oil cakes.
Mm-hmm.
There can be intra-commodity trade. In fact, the global trade, if you see, almost two-thirds of global trade today take place on an intra-industry or an intra-commodity basis. So, for instance, a particular variety of, or a particular type of medicine India exports, it also imports another variety of medicine. USA exports cars, it also imports cars. So there is no contradiction. I mean, it is possible always that we have our markets for oil cakes.
Mm-hmm.
We are exporting.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to lose those markets, you know, because when we have surplus to do so and we can maintain and sustain that, we should be doing that and earn foreign exchange earnings. At the same time, when we have shortage, we can actually import oil cakes. So, by banning exports of a particular product, what happens is that it creates a situation of uncertainty and we lose out our export destinations to our competitors. And that is why the decision on trade is not exactly the way many others expect it to be.
Mm-hmm. That's right. But now, let's touch upon the fuel reform aspect too. It was said that, you know, drought is probably, any situation like drought, is probably going to make it a little difficult for the government to politically take up the measures that it wants to take in terms of fuel reforms. And, you know, for a very long time now, we've been watching that at least the Economic Advisory Council has been saying that increase the prices of diesel by rupees 5 per litre. And that this should be something which should just come up. And this would be something which would lead us towards the entire decontrol of the diesel in particular. But this, in fact, what Mr. Ahluwalia has also said, that probably this is not the right time now, since monsoon is again playing a sports role.
So I would say that the monsoon has come to the aid of farmers and others who don't expect, who don't want diesel prices to go up. And I think it is a political call that the government will take whenever it wants to take. I don't think it is, even now if they have not taken a decision, you know, on one hand they are giving a diesel subsidy to farmers, mm-hmm. on the other hand if they go for increasing diesel prices, so it will be a decision in contradiction. Mm-hmm. So I think it is a political decision.
But this entire issue has become quite a fix for the government. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a lot has been said about it, but I think in the back of our minds, we all know that this is not going to happen tomorrow. Mm-hmm. You know, even if they propose, even if there's a main economic advisory body which is saying that increase the prices, it's not going to happen just like that. Why is decontrolling on it a very complicated issue
now? Because it affects the common man, it affects the people, it will have a cascading effect. Because see, the rise in petrol prices does not affect the movement of your food grain.
And fuel also drives the politics.
Absolutely, fuel drives the politics, the politics of the world in fact.
Yeah.
So, as I said, this is a political decision that the government will take when it takes.
While I agree with what the advisory council says, or whatever thoughts are there on subsidy removal and decontrolling prices, but you see, it's not only the politics of subsidies, it is also the economics of subsidies. Many times we feel that as if subsidies are just a drain on public expenditure.
Yes.
It may be true, but it is just a partial truth. Because there is an economics of subsidy whereby when you give subsidy to a particular segment of your society, and especially, you know, the area that we are talking of is a very impoverished and a large absolute number, there subsidies do generate additional incomes. Because, I mean, in some way, subsidies are actually compensating for some expenditure, right? Now, that compensation increases the disposable income in the hands of the subsidy recipients.
Mm.
And that availability of disposable income generates demand. And here in this case, for instance, rural demand. And that is why, you know, the FMCG, have been doing very well, fast-moving consumer goods in the rural areas, and they are not bothered about monsoon, or because rural incomes are actually rising. Rural incomes are not only rising because of Mahatma Gandhi NREGS by upward revision of rural wages, but also because of these subsidies that are actually compensating for something which is making them additional resources available in their hands, which is leading to demand for products that are actually produced in the industrial sector.
Mm-hmm.
And that is very important, because a large population in rural area is today a demander of industrial products, of day-to-day consumption. And that has a very positive effect on the industrial and manufacturing segment, which is actually not doing that well.
Mm-hmm. That's right. But this subsidy also happens to be and is looked upon as a burden for the government in some or the other ways. And of course, so we look at that aspect too. Time for a very short break in Inside the Studio.
Kanuni Ulthan. Unfiltered Sawala. Jaya to Jaya ka Jawab. हमारे पास
are men from Mars
and women from Venus?
Who is the better half?
Who takes the decisions?
Who is responsible?
Who is demanding?
Who is submissive?
Who is independent?
Can men and women ever find common ground? To find out, watch Gender Discourse. Every Thursday, 4 p.m. only on Lok Sabha TV.
बारिश का मजा तो सब लेते हैं, पर बारिश का पानी बचाने की बात कौन सोचता है?
हाँ?
बारिश के पानी का संरक्षण करें, ताकि पानी की कमी ना हो और आप जिंदगी का यूं ही मजा लेते रहें।
Welcome back to Insight. In Insight today, we're talking about wind deficit and the concerns. Right. So before going into the break, we were talking about the subsidies and how crucial the subsidies are for the farm sector. But Dr. Das, I would like to in fact come back to you here. Since we're talking about subsidies, it's very important to address the issue of subsidy burden, which has become a talking point since we are a country who believe a lot on the figures, whether it's the growth figure or the rising fiscal deficit or is the current account deficit, and much of this is also attributed to the subsidy burden of the government, whether it's in the form of the fertilizer subsidy, the fuel subsidy or any other form of subsidy going to the farm sector. How do you look at the management on that particular front? Have we not been successful in managing it, or do you think that it's the call of the time? I mean, we'll have to certainly look for the way out and, of course, continue with the measures that we do.
Let me set the record straight. Subsidies are definitely a burden on the exchequer, and we do need fiscal discipline. And I'm all for that. But you know, we have to see the issue of subsidy in a context. And the context is that India is a particular stage of development today. Given this stage of development, though we are doing very well as compared to many other countries and as compared to our own past record, we should not forget that we have a very daunting task ahead, and it's a very long and winding road where a large section of our population, even if poverty levels are actually declining, which is very heartening, in absolute number, we have to get them out of abject poverty. And if you see the direction of subsidies, the sectors that are targeted through subsidies, these are actually devised in a developmental context. Even developed countries, and I may very safely name even the US, give subsidies to its farmers, where agriculture is too minuscule a share of its overall GDP. There are minuscule percentages of population that are dependent on US agriculture. And the subsidies that they give in different forms, the names are different. Somewhere it is called income decoupled support, somewhere it is export subsidy, whatever. The amount of subsidy given by US and European Union to their farmers is many-fold as compared to many developing countries put together, and that includes India. So I think we have to see subsidy issue in a context. But I do not disagree by what you are saying that our subsidies are a drag. Their management has been, and the implementation of that is something which is not in the most efficient way. And that is where I think the most important aspect of this whole thing is tackling the corruption and malpractices, you know, which is not only related to subsidies, but it's a widespread phenomenon. So many times we feel that the root cause of the problems inherent with subsidy, which is becoming a drag and burden on fiscal position, is not getting addressed, which is the managerial portion which you very rightly mentioned. So I guess if we focus on that and see how we can still keep the developmental role of subsidies for which it was originally planned and devised, I think it is going to stay for some more time. And I don't think anybody can say that subsidies would be over at any point of time.
It's considered as really good for the agriculture sector, for the farmers, but when it is about the economic management related to subsidy, where do you see India's performance? How do you look at India's performance then?
The UK government has from the beginning been saying that they want to move away from subsidies. It is not now, it is even earlier. And they have in a certain way, you know, they are trying to withdraw. But my point is that the subsidies are not really reaching the farmers. We are giving fertilizer subsidy to the industry. If you are giving for drip and sprinkler irrigation, again it's to the industry. So giving on tractor and this and that, it's all to the industry. It is not coming to the farmer. It is of course in the name of farmer. So I don't know the economics of subsidy as he put it in such great detail. But my point is that the subsidy now, you know, there is also a move to withdraw any concessions given in power sector to farmers, you know, for irrigation, saying that, you know, giving concessions in power is really costing a lot to the government and all, and it leads to overdrawal. It is a, it's a point, it is a correct point, it leads to overdrawal. But you know, you cannot have this one yardstick for everybody. You cannot have the same yardstick for industry and for the farmer who's really, their income has really not gone up as much as it was expected that it would. And you cannot just, you know, have the same yardstick for both the sectors. So, what I'm trying to say is that subsidies really don't reach the farmers, and they're in the name of farmers, but they're actually going to the industry.
That's right. But you know, looking at, and with the ease that you explained as to what the government has really come up with, whether it's something in the store like a contingency plan, whether it's some other measures that the government is taking, two more weeks. One question that comes to our minds is that, is our Indian economy getting more immune to a situation like drought? Is the situation changing? What is your point?
No. Let me just tell you that we are progressing. We are moving away from the last few years when, you know, we acted or we acted much later into a drought situation. Now we do have contingency plans, and more than that, we have a Rashtriya Krishi Vikas Yojana that the government launched, I think, 2 years ago, under which it has given a lot of flexibility to states, you know, to come up with their own schemes, their own projects, their need-based projects, you know, and take funds for that. So there is flexibility in that kind of funding. So that has helped the states a lot in planning the way they want to plan their agriculture as per their specific areas and their climate, whatever is available to them. So, what I'm trying to say is that the contingency plans appear to be on paper, but they are there, and their implementation really lies in the hands of the states, because you have to move your seeds very quickly to farmers who want late sown varieties, or who want short duration varieties, or who want drought resistant varieties. You should make sure that you have those seeds available with you, and you are able to move them quickly. Now, whether that is happening or not on the ground is something that really needs to be seen. Yes. Mr. Sharad Pawar has undertaken a tour of, is already on a tour.
That's
of
right.
These states, yeah, along with Mr. Jairam Ramesh, the Rural Development Minister. And it needs to be seen that when they come back, because they're going to have another meeting of their power group of ministers after they visit the areas themselves. We will see the difference between what they did earlier or what they were looking at earlier and what they do later and what is their perception later, which will also make us wiser about how their schemes are being implemented.
That's right. But I'll put the same question to you, Dr. Das. Do you think that our Indian economy is now getting more, it's now more immune to a situation like drought?
Certainly. I feel if you see the situation between post-independence and now, you know, we began with how much? Around 50 million tons, you know, in 50s, and by 2000, I think it had crossed 200 million. And, you know, I mean, you see the progress. Many times you feel, you know, last 60, 65 years we have wasted. Post-independence era. But that's not true. I guess a lot has happened, and if you see today's results of NSSO, the rural incomes have risen at 18% as compared to the urban areas, and that is something which is very positive, because if you see the aggregate GDP growth, which is being debated, and every other day you have a downward revision in terms of projection of GDP growth. Here, rural income is increasing, and mind you, in real terms, not in nominal terms, by taking into account the inflation, it is rising at 18%. And this is happening between 2009-10 and 2010-11 and 11-12. This is enormous. I mean, this is much, much higher than the national average of income growth. This only suggests that the kind of cost of living, the kind of affordability of that cost of living in the rural sector, and the income is also increasing in urban areas, and the way agriculture industry linkages have got strengthened over the years. I think you are very right in asking the question or suggesting that today Indian economy is getting insulated by the vagaries of monsoon.
Mm-hmm. But since you mentioned even earlier that these figures, one can't put them in relation with what the NREGS or schemes like those have done to the rural India, because this is not around the employment guarantee scheme that you find that the rural, the income is really increasing, but it is to do with the agriculture sector, right? But at the same time, it's the same NSSO that once said that farmers would like to quit farming if given a second option, because they are still suffering. I mean, we are talking about the majority, not to the, not to certain areas where you see, of course, they're performing well because of the conventional wisdom that the farmers possess, or, certain states, as you also said, really providing those facilities that they're supposed to their farmers. Because it's the farmers, I mean, majority is a rural population where they get the votes from. So that happens, that comes automatically in a state's policies. But how do you look at this stark reality?
See, these two things can coexist. There is no contradiction that today farming activity, the level at which it has reached, is increasingly getting insulated by the situations in monsoon or rainfall deficit or surplus. If you take data for the last 10 years, and you will find it in economic survey, you have meteorological subdivisions. And if you see rainfall, surplus and deficits, how many divisions, subdivisions were in the surplus area or deficit area. Each year you will find that there are some regions in both. So monsoon, rainfall deficit or surplus depending on monsoon in no year gives you an absolute figure of only surplus or only deficit. It's a mixed bag in each year. Now, that therefore, this problem of rain deficit of today is not only specific to this year. I mean, if you see, it has been mitigated over the years. If there is a time series analysis you can do. Therefore, when you suggest that today we are getting insulated, I don't see any reason to say no, we are getting insulated. This is one reality. The other reality is that the broader, reforms, the broader infrastructural development, the broader incentives that have to be made available to the farming community, that is still missing. That has not reached its pinnacle. So these are two different facts, and both can coexist. There is no contradiction.
That's right. So, and we have to live with these two facts, because that's how the agriculture sector is performing. Well, certainly there are some sort of benefits that, of course, the farmers must be receiving, but at the same time, we don't see. In fact, the studies reveal that farmers do not want to continue with agriculture. They would like to rather go for an alternative when it comes to deciding as to what they really want to pursue. Time here to take a very short break in Insight. Stay tuned.
हमारे जीवन में बदलाव लाने वाले विज्ञान के ऐतिहासिक प्रयोग जिन्होंने एक्सरे पेनिसिलिन हरित क्रांति ग्रीन हाउस प्रभाव अर्धचालकों एवं रक्त समूहों की खोजों में योगदान दिया आप जानेंगे पाचन की प्रक्रिया और मॉर्गन एवं ग्रिफिथ और सर सीवी रमन के प्रयोगों को धारावाहिक कुछ तुक्के कुछ तीर के माध्यम से देखिए हर शनिवार सुबह 10:30 बजे सिर्फ लोकसभा चैनल पर
ये पानी मेरा है नहीं मेरा है
तेरा मेरा मत कर सासू ये पानी तो सबका है थोड़ा थोड़ा बांट लो इसको ये पानी तो सबका है कैसे ये मुश्किल हल होगी हम सबको ये सोचना है
पानी बर्बाद नहीं करेंगे इस्तेमाल करेंगे
ऐसे भविष्य से बचने के लिए पानी बर्बाद ना करें और बारिश के पानी का संरक्षण करें
Welcome back to Insight and Insight today we are talking about the concerns around the drought-like situation in some parts of the country. Right. One very crucial factor is that we cannot segregate these two things, that is agriculture and monsoon and the interdependence. For as many years we haven't been able to do it. Now, as we understand, there's this Ministry of Earth Sciences that is going to launch a new five-year monsoon mission at the cost of about $75 million to get a better understanding of this very this atmospheric phenomenon. You know, around the dependence that we have on these predictions, maybe that can be, to an extent, it can be sorted out. But is this really what India needs? What is it that we should be doing to ensure that agriculture, which is employing over half of this country's population, enjoys the priority that it should in our economy?
See, forecast of monsoon is one aspect. For as of now, you know, they are computing 100 years data and they are coming up with these figures. And I'm told that nowhere in the world monsoon forecast has really been that accurate. And we seem to be doing okay on that front. But we need to improve, of course, because so that the farmers. Farmers, let me tell you, are not really only dependent on what the IMD says. As you just now mentioned a little while ago about conventional wisdom.
Yeah.
For years we have been seeing photographs of a farmer looking up at the sky like this.
Time to get over.
Yeah, time to get over. The one crucial thing is that if we are going to face problems in water availability, which we are going to, water being a finite source, we need to look at how to conserve water, how to have smaller schemes, how to, as I said, conserve every drop where it falls. You know, we need to look at seriously at small projects for water instead of going for big dams. We have got big dams just now and we are still in trouble.
That's right.
You know, in areas that we've got big dams, we've got in Punjab and Haryana. And let me tell you, the reservoir position is so low today, it is 19% of full reservoir level on 19th July. Of course, it has increased now to 24%. And it is 55% of last year's average.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a deficiency in water levels in 12 states in the country today. And what is Punjab? What are Punjab farmers doing? They are going for groundwater. So either way, you know, we are very stressed for water. We need to really look at projects, and I don't think we are paying adequate attention to one, maintaining the dams, maintaining the projects that we have, number two, going for smaller projects. Secondly, if we are seeing that the water availability is going to be lesser than what it has been in the previous year, we need to change our cropping pattern. We need to go in areas where we don't have enough water to go for crops that don't require. We don't have to go for paddy and sugarcane everywhere. We can go for other types of crops, and we should go in irrigated areas for such crops that require lesser water.
Mm.
And thirdly, we should really improve the forecast system.
That's right. But you know, these two steps alone would go a long way.
They would go a long way.
That's actually
in areas where rivers have been revived, like in near Alwar in Rajasthan, there they have changed the entire crop. It has taken 8 to 10 years, no doubt.
Mm.
But they have looked at what is good for them. What is good for them. And also you need to look at the soil health. The way the soil health is getting depleted because people are taking more than one crop. You know, earlier people used to take one crop. Now they are taking 2 to 3 crops everywhere and they are not really not caring about the soil health.
Mm.
So all these things put together needs to be given a very hard look, and you need to take decisions to see that.
But you know, these things are only happening in patches. Let's say some parts of Tamil Nadu, other parts of Andhra Pradesh, you said some parts of Rajasthan, Punjab. It's only happening in patches.
And
right?
It's happening through NGO effort, more than government effort.
That is farmer-farmer exchange. That's
yes, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. Dr. Das, why is it that we are not really working towards that direction? Whenever we have panelists like you on the panel, we've always come across such very bright suggestions, ideas, and we understand, you know, that there are so many people with such bright ideas in this country. Why is it that it's so difficult to put those ideas into action?
That is where there is over-politicization of agriculture sector, I guess. And there is no dearth of good ideas. There are very good studies. The Prime Minister and his Council of Ministers has very good advisors. Not that people do not understand these problems, they do. there are schemes that are already there. There have been initiatives already launched. I think the problem is not about ideas. The problem is not about even policy. The policy implementation is the major problem. And that's why I touched upon this issue that even agriculture sector, due to political vested interests and due to unfair monetary interests, I think we are doing a world of bad to something which is so very crucial for our food security and self-sufficiency. And the basic point that you had raised, that how do we retain farmers in the farm? I think the kind of push private sector contract farming has to be given, has not been given. Private sector also has not reached out to agriculture sector to the extent that it could have had, despite the fact that there are many companies that have targeted the bottom of the pyramid. We also feel that the value-added segment of agriculture, which relates to dairy, poultry, aquaculture, horticulture, sericulture, this is being developed in many, many parts, but in patches. Again, this is something which is not happening. We have had very successful examples of cooperatives. It is not
replicated. We have schemes to address and cater to every sector that you mentioned.
Exactly. But those schemes are there. The policies are there. It is not getting implemented. So, agriculture sector's problem is only reflective of problem which is very widely, you know, visible. So implementation is a problem in perhaps all walks of life, at least in India.
That's right.
But the positive aspect is where there is will, there is way. We also see wherever the government wanted to do something, it has been able to do that. Wherever the private sector has been wanting to do something, they have been able to do that. And that is why, you know, I mean, the whole idea of we being emerging economy or many sectors, you know, doing so well, say in IT, automobiles, pharma, and so on. My point is, wherever government wanted to do something, it has been able to do that. Private sector wanted to do something, it has been able to do that. I think we are not wanting our agriculture sector to do well because we don't consider that to be as a priority. Otherwise, we would have made that.
But then, sir, situation is not going to improve. I mean, at this point of time, when we are sitting here, we are talking about drought-led situation, how to revive agriculture. In some part of this country, I mean, even in the national capital, there's thousands of people sitting there protesting against the rising corruption in the country. So let's face it, this is not going to improve tomorrow. But what to do about this entire center? Gargi, do you think that, you know, this mass mobilization, you said that the NGOs are working well, this mass mobilization is now required at the farmer level. And this farmer-to-farmer contact has to increase, and somebody will have to take the initiative here. Can a farmer take this initiative, or do the NGOs will have to certainly do this?
Mass mobilization to remove corruption is required in every sector of our life, because it touches every sector of our life. And I think people who are sitting on Dharna, and people like Anna Hazare and all, they have raised a voice, they have raised an awareness, as they say, they have raised an awakening. And their movement may be floundering a bit now, but they have sown the seed. That is important. In the case of the farming sector, private sector will never come in the farming sector. It is not investing in the farming sector because it's a risky sector.
That's right.
You are not sure of the returns. Now today, as of now, you don't know if the monsoon will be good, you'll get returns. If it will not be, you won't. Farmer takes credit. He doesn't know if he'll be able to repay that credit. A lot of credit is coming from the informal sector. Farmers who are not able to pay, they are dying, they are committing suicides. So this sector, when it requires, it comes and it revolves the economy. When your manufacturing fails, when your service sector fails, then it is the farming sector which has revived the economy. But it does not receive the same kind of patronage or the same kind, because now what you are doing, you are wanting to take away subsidies, you are wanting to take away electricity subsidy, and you are wanting to price water. You are trying to do all kinds of things for the farmer. Farmer's income is still not meeting his input costs. And there are a whole lot of risk involved. You are not even giving insurance to farmers that is required to be given. So amidst all that risk, farmers are producing and they are living up to the expectations of the country. Private sector is not going to look at the farming sector. Private sector will certainly look at agro sector, they will look at food processing, they will look at packed food. They will not look at this sector where as one of the ministers used to say ki farmer kitchen mein khada hoke suraj udne se pehle field mein jata hai aur wo kaam karta hai, and we know how he works. He's willing to do that. So these are some of the aspects that really really need to be looked and hard decisions need to be taken. There was a move that government will try to ensure that farmers are at the mercy of Arthiyas, the middleman. That has nothing has been done on that. When the suicides of farmers were at its peak, when the government came up with the package, then it was said that the government will look at the credit part of the farming sector. Nothing has happened. You are giving more credit to farmers, you are making more credit available through the banks. But how will the farmer return if he doesn't get returns? That's the monsoon is weak. So it's a cycle.
It's a cycle. Dr. Das?
I don't know how come private capital goes to stock market in much riskier ventures for speculation, and they are not going to farming segment, which is also risky. It is a matter of priority. I think we are so attuned to casino capitalism that there we can take risk, but something which is so very vital, we don't want to go and take risk. And it's too difficult. That is a dichotomy. I think we need to raise awareness about it.
We have to raise awareness about this. We have to make sure that the farmers also participate in this process. But at the same time, the government will certainly have to do action, because no matter how hard we try, this decision has to come from the government side, not only in making the policies, but also implementing it to a comfortable level. So thanks very much, Shigali. Thanks very much, Dr. Das, for talking to us. Quite a pleasure having you here. So certainly, the problem of the agriculture sector, the farm sector, is not going to improve in a very short time. But of course, the steps are required, and good steps, in fact, which have a direction in terms of its results also, they are required to be taken. And for that, a good vision should be there first on the paper, which implements at the ground level. So that's all we have for in this edition of Insight. Thanks very much for watching us.